प्लीज या ओके सो टुडे गाइस लेट अस स्टार्ट द आवर डिस्कशंस ऑन चबी एंड एज वी ऑलवेज से दिस इज मोर ऑफ एन ओपन डिस्कशन एंड आई विल बी गोइंग थ्रू ऑल दिस चबी व्हाट एवर आई हैव गॉन थ्रू फ्रॉम डिफरेंट साइड्स एंड दीज आर नॉट एनीथिंग ऑफ माई माइंड बट इट्स जस्ट गोइंग थ्रू ऑल द ब्लॉग्स and just trying to collect all the information and share with you guys. So there might be some incorrect things, or if you find anything can be improved, or if you want to add anything at any time, please interrupt me and speak up, and always chime in wherever you feel you would like to add something. Okay. Here to start with. So this is Chubby, and Chubby is a log service. That is what they say most of the time. They always say it's just a log service, okay, and then we'll see what it is more in detail. But Chubby is always compared to a Zookeeper, and they are almost similar systems, I would say, but still Chubby stands out, and it's from Google. And what are the key points and all those things? That is the reason. First I would like to start with a comparison of Zookeeper and Chubby. Okay, so to just start with, what are the similarities? And I know Zookeeper, we have been going through Zookeeper for last couple of weeks, and there are a lot of discussions about it. Sri has more information and inputs about that. But still, if anything you feel, please add here. So the similarities, what I found is, one is it can be used as a distributed log service. Why I'm saying, because Zookeeper can be done, actually does more things and than the log service, and the log service is not given so much of a priority, I think. But Chubby is more of a log service, so at least Zookeeper can be also used as a distributed log service, and therefore both actually can do this functionality. But Chubby does just log service, distributed log service. Okay, and then we'll come to all the details about Chubby later. But the second is, and they both read and write small files. So whatever the data they store, it is not of high volumes. It is very small data what they store. And it makes sense, right? Because these are all more of consensus services or coordination services, wherein other application components would like to store some information there and try to get an access. And it can be used across the components or by the same components or for different modules and all that stuff. So it's just a small repository, which we want to keep on changing it whenever we require. So it's like more of a storage of a metadata and all that stuff, or maybe configuration files. So therefore, whatever the information, we don't have to store a huge database, like maybe something what we discussed in Kafka, or maybe like Cassandra. So that's not a huge database, but it's small things what we have to store. And therefore it says read and write just small files what we do. Third is, they both provide a similar interface, like a Unix based file system. That is what the interface, it is what for both of them. And fourth is, they provide mechanisms to follow up changes on files. So whenever there are some modifications of files or maybe directories, so you'll get an events in case of Chubby, and you'll actually get watches on case of Chubby. So any of the nodes, whatever the changes we have, we can actually subscribe. Different clients can subscribe for different watches in Zookeeper, and the same thing with events also in Chubby. And both contain session system for file accesses. So every time we have to access any of the nodes in Chubby, at least you establish a session with that. And then it may, if you want to have access to a log, you just open that log, and therefore you establish a session with that particular log, right? So, or maybe that file. And then the third is, the clients have to go over leader or master for write operations in both of them. So the write operations always go through the master, leader, whatever you call it, in case of Zookeeper as well as Chubby. And a single replicated log is maintained, okay? So I really didn't think about more about this, but I think it's more about whenever it's like a commit log sort of, right? Write add log. So it's a single replicate log. It might be on some file server. So, okay. Then third is, they both have regular and ephemeral nodes. right? So that is the normal similarity between both of them. And now the differences. So the difference is what is talked about in Zookeeper, and some of the sites says Zookeeper more is about process coordinator. So you have different processes, distributed processes running, and then you want someone to coordinate. And that is what a Zookeeper does, is very good at, okay? But in Chubby, they say it's a completely distributed log service only, okay? So that is a major difference between both of them. And when you say coordinator, so what is thought of most of the time is the consistency is not very good, in the sense it's a relaxed consistency. It's more of sort of a weaker consistency. That is what is said in some places. But Chubby has a very strict consistency, and this consistency is very seriously followed in Chubby. So whenever we update any of the information in any of the node, that data, whatever we have updated, it gets distributed across all the clients at the same time. Okay, yeah, there are some performance issues that we can actually look in more detail as we go for Chubby. And third is the native client library do not have cache in Zookeeper, but in Chubby, the client library provides cache management. So this is very different in Chubby. So we have a cache for a client library, but in case of Zookeeper, we don't have it. But I think Zookeeper, they use some other wrapper, I forgot its name. I think it's a curator or something. And then, but it's another library on top of it, or maybe, yeah. And then you can convert Zookeeper the way the Chubby has. But Zookeeper's principal design, it is that they don't support caching, and that is for a reason, because that is what the Zookeeper is designed for. Okay, so both systems are slightly different, and that is what actually we are coming here. And then we have clients may communicate to any server for read operations in the case of Zookeeper, but that doesn't happen in Chubby. In Chubby, the read and write both have to always go to the master or leader. Okay, so that is the difference in Chubby, and Zookeeper it isn't. But in Chubby, the other replicas, okay, of a cluster, or we call it cell in this case, they actually, then what is the use of them is, like, whenever a request comes to that replica, it actually forwards to the master. That is the only thing what it can do. Okay, so that is the difference about Chubby. And fourth, in Zookeeper, it provides four different watches to follow file changes. But case of Chubby, we have seven events to follow all the file or the directory changes. So on a high level, this is what was the difference and similarity. But if you look at the Chubby, these first three requirements, first three differences are the key in case of Chubby, and they are very important. One is, it is a distributed log service only. Second, it is a strict consistency. And third, it provides a cache management. And that also gives an upper hand for Chubby based on all these three differences. Okay, so now let's go and discuss Chubby. Okay, so as Chubby, what is the purpose of Chubby? It's like, as we know, it is a log service, a distributed log service. And the way it, most of the blogs or most of the information is put up is the Chubby log service is a distributed coarse-grained logging service. Okay, and the word coarse-grained log is very important here. And then we'll come to know about it more. But what is a coarse-grained log is you can hold a log for a longer time. In case of fine-grained log, wherein you can hold a log for maybe a second or lesser than a second, microsecond, millisecond, and all that stuff. But that is not the case with here. And so in the fine-grained, you actually have to quickly release it. But in the coarse-grained, you can hold a log for a very long time, like maybe hours and also days. And that is what it is different over here. So that is why it says it is a distributed coarse-grained log service. And so a log service is a form of a consensus service. Okay, that, and what it says, it converts the problem of reaching consensus to handling out logs. Okay, so this is what a basic definition of a Chubby log service is. And also, a distributed set of processes would try to compete to acquire a log. Okay, just like normal lock, what we use in any application, were it not a distributed system, if we had to develop some small application, maybe it's a desktop-based application, and we have different processes or different threads which are competing for a lock. So exactly the same principle is actually applied over here, but in a distributed fashion. And it's not so easy to implement. It's very difficult, but they have tried to implement it as best as possible. And what is Chubby? Chubby was an internal service within Google for a very long time. And so what they talk about is the high level. First of all, it is highly available locking mechanism. So most of the time when we talk about locking service, it also stores a data along with the lock, you know. So whenever it opens a node in a particular Chubby system, so basically when you want to write, you open a node. So actually when you open a node or create a node in any of the Chubby, so then you actually write some data on it. So that particular file along with the lock actually is the key of the whole system over here. Okay, so therefore, if you look at the purpose, it's like a file system for small files. Small files are nothing but all the file system is like, it's a repository of small objects. And then you have a lock service on each and every object. So that is what it is. You have an object and then you have a lock on that. So as good as you are actually providing a lock and the objects are the shared resources, you know. So that is what the Chubby system is. And it was internal service within Google. And so that is what the way it started. So if we look at the design goals first, let's go through that. The first one is about high availability. So it has to be high available, and that is one of the key. And also it is highly reliable also. So whatever we have stored in it will always be there for almost ever. And so whenever we write, you know, so the writes are very low in case like whenever we make a modification. And basically the main purpose of the locking service and Chubby, and it's discussed widely, is for leader elections, right? So whenever we have to leader election, that doesn't happen very frequent, isn't it? So it happens and then it remains, a particular node, it remains a leader for a very long time. And then if it fails, then you have a failover and again you start an election, right? So that time, when you are selecting a leader, at the time you write something on a node and then you keep on reading it. So what happens, the other replicas of that particular client, they keep on reading it to find who the leader is, isn't it? Therefore, there will be a lot of high reads. The volume of reads will be high than the volume of writes, and therefore it is low writes and high reads. And also it says clients would not read stale data, and that is the very key point over here. So because we are using a caching mechanism on the client side, and that also Chubby provides a client library, so that actually has cache in it, and that cache management is also done by Chubby. So therefore, the clients will never see a stale data. And the way the cache handle is basically is write through cache, and it's invalidated whenever there is an update in any of the Chubby's node. Okay. So when it is invalidated, at that time it flushes whatever is in the cache, and then it keeps on for the next read. It hits on the server. It hits on the log service, Chubby service, and gets the data from that. So therefore, you will never see stale data whenever the data is modified in Chubby. And that is what a very, that was the purpose of all of that. And this is what the key design goals are. Okay. Any questions so far? Or anyone wants to add anything?
I think, go ahead. Yeah.
So quick question on this one. So how would client will not see the, because the server will, if any other resource has been released, how could clients know?
Could you come again? I didn't get it. Sorry.
So clients would not read the stale data you mentioned, but I was just wanted to understand how, when the server sees that release of the lock on one of the resources, how would clients know?
Release of a lock.
I think there is session time, right? This is like if a log is allocated to someone, this chubby log, there will be session time of whatever, let's say X units of time, right? So once the X unit of time is over, that log will be free, and then I think client will be notified.
No, client will be notified?
Yeah, no. I think, see, the way you are talking about, there are two things. One is data updation. It's just like the normal cache. You just invalidate it. But when you see a lock, you know, and if there is a failover, isn't it? So how that is notified? That is notified by events.
Okay. We'll know more, I think, when we deep dive.
Yeah. These are the very high level things, I've got here. But yeah, that's a very important point. Yeah. And Shashank, I'm sorry, I just cut into you. So what was you discussing about?
No, I was trying to point that the difference between the normal locks and the chubby locks, right? In normal locks, you don't have those exclusive locks. There, we don't have any kind of session time, right? But in chubby and all, you have a session time. Like after a certain time, the lock becomes free. But in exclusive, you have exclusive locks and all. I think explicitly you need to, customize the time or something like that to make them free.
So are you saying about the advisory locks and the mandatory locks?
Yeah, kind of.
Okay. Yeah, but they don't have any time. Maybe I need to read more about it. But I've never seen some time like that. But that's a good point you brought in. So the way what I understood is like you will always have an advisory lock, in the sense whenever whichever client goes in, okay, and client also you will have replicas, right? So one of them actually wants to become a leader, so it will first go in that and hold the lock, right? So that will be the master. Okay, and the others actually can read the log and its data, but they can just read and they cannot acquire the log, but they can just read and use that data.
Okay, so, they can't write, but they can read it. Yeah.
So it's a shared the log. What they are, it's in a shared mode. So exclusive log is only for the first client or the first node which goes and writes into a log or tries to acquire the log, right? So that is the way it is. Yeah, but I've never heard of a time lease for
time that. In the sense, there is an advantage of chubby, right? Let's say you applied that shared log, exclusive log on something, right? On some block. And that, let's say it got failed. So if it gets filled, that lock can never be used by any other.
Because, I got your point. Yeah.
But so, in chubby, there is a session. Once the session time is over, whether it has got filled or not, that resource will be available for other streams.
So the failover. Okay. So that is slightly different. Yeah. What you're saying makes sense. But that is rightly. I'm also not prepared for that. So we'll see that in later sessions. Sure. Yeah, but that's a good point. So. Now, secondly, I just went through one of the papers and saw that typically the load will be like for a particular chubby cell, you can serve like around 10,000K clients. So that is what a huge load it can easily handle. And second, at one instance, you need per data center, at least one. I see it is sufficient also. But in some cases, you might have more, okay? But it's not required though. But typically they go for one instance, and one instance of a chubby, it means a whole one cell. So one cell is like a cluster in case of a Kafka, but in here the cluster or the cell, it's only about five servers together. They form a cluster, a cell. And also they say in some cases you have some of the nodes across data centers. So that is also possible, and that might be true in most of the cases. But I don't know. So, but this is just information I gathered around. So, and just to show how powerful it is and how it can be configured in different ways. And the interface way is like you have a simple file interface. So we know the file interface, like if it's a normal file interface, what we do is we actually open a file, then we read a file, and then we write it to a file, and then we close a file, something like that. But the only difference here, and also when we are reading from a file, so we always maintain a file pointer which keeps on moving, and there we have, therefore we can have a seek or something like that, right? So it can just access blocks of a file from any of the file systems, right? But here in this case, what they say is whenever you do perform a read and write on a file, you have to do a whole read or whole write. So you cannot do a chunks of file reading. Okay, so that, or the sequential file reading per block, or maybe randomly going to a block and reading it. So that is not possible. You have to read the whole file, or you have to write the whole file. So that is the only difference in the normal file interface and what Chubby is following. Okay, so that is what slight difference over here. And second, for a developer's interface, it is nothing but it's like a coarse grained synchronization. Okay, so what does that mean? As like whenever we use a log in a normal OS log, we actually try to acquire it, and most of the time it's across the critical section, right? So you acquire it and then you follow the whole critical section and you release it. So it is exactly like that, and the reason why it is because it's more appealing to us, because the developer community is more it is more easy for them to understand the logs. Instead, if we were given a library of a Paxos and we were asked to implement it, so because Paxos implementation is more like a state machine, isn't it? So you have to maintain all the states and all those. There are some more complexities. So in order to avoid that, if we are given just logs, and based on the logs, if you are able to get the consensus algorithm implemented, that will be a very cool thing. And that is the reason it has been implemented this way. And developer interface, they talk about leader election. That is a very important thing. And what is leader election? And also, it is one of the common use cases here. So the leader election is something what they call it, when there are about 4 to 5 different nodes, they are competing to be a leader. So whoever goes and gets an access of the log and write into a log, that node becomes a leader. So on a high level, that is what a leader election is. And that is very easy because, you know, for a developer interface also, if we have many of these replicas, we just have to go and write to a log, try to acquire the log. And whoever gets the log, that node becomes a leader, and he writes its own data in it. So others can just read the log in a shared mode and understand who the leader is. So that will be very simple and easy to implement also. If we compare the implementation of using a consensus algorithm using Paxos, right? So this is what they were talking about. And so a brief about what they were saying in when actually Chubby development started before that. So what it was said is in Google, they were having different methods and ad hoc methods of actually having, for a distributed system to use a primary elections and all that thing. And in some cases, it was also, they were doing operator interventions. Okay, so it was something like a manual or maybe some ad hoc ways, and different systems were using their own ways of doing it. So they actually came up with this Chubby as a common system for all of these use cases for their internal use. And what they could achieve is, the first thing what they achieved, and very important to know, is because it significantly improved the availability, right? So why availability? Because in some cases they were using a human intervention, and therefore if there is a failover, you know, like if a master fails and if you have an operator to actually, you start a master, it's going to surely take some more time, and therefore you will have take a hit on availability in that case. But now if you automate all that stuff, it's just basically you are automating all that stuff, isn't it? So if you automate that, then it becomes easier, and that is you're improving the availability on that case. And that is not the only thing, but as we go in detail, we find out, because see, whenever we are changing from one leader to another, means if you are making a follower node to a leader because the previous leader has crashed, so even if it looks like everything is switching over, but still there is a gap of 2-3 seconds in some cases wherein you are in a transition mode, right? So that also particular period, they have handled it. And the way they handle it, the way they say is, you know, they claim to say that because we are using caching, okay, because the client's library has a caching, and therefore, even if there is during the leader election, if we have a transition period, so that doesn't have an impact on any of the client applications because all the data is already cached. Okay, so this is the way they are handling that. Okay, and therefore they say the whole system is highly available. Okay, so that is a very key point. And maybe because if you look at the cache and if you look at the events, what they are doing it, that might be a good way and it might be working. And also they claim that they have not discovered any different algorithm. They are just using the normal, whatever they have, everyone is being using. And just, and also, they are still using the consensus, the Paxos underneath, and that is what they say, or maybe like a Paxos. I'm not very sure on that, but in some cases, in some of the blogs, it's being said Paxos, and in some cases, they are saying like Paxos. So I'm not very clear about that though. So this is what actually the whole thing is. Okay. And anything about, before we move to the design rational. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
The third point stores leader election data for advertisement. Design rational.
Oh, yeah. So we'll go there. Okay. So design rational. Yeah. So this is what actually now, if we just look at the common use cases before going in that. So leader election is very simple, isn't it? So if many of the nodes are competing for leader, so whoever actually gets locked first actually is the leader. Okay, so naming service is nothing but a DNS. Okay, and what it talks about in a DNS, so the normal DNS, the way the normal DNS works is, so it is actually based on a, it is also using a cache, isn't it? So, but the only difference is, so it is a time-based caching, right? So DNS has a TTL. So whenever you have a value stored in a DNS or a DNS entry, so it also has a TTL. So what is said is it is like more of a time-based caching. So you have a TTL specified for it. And the only problem will be if your TTL is longer, and so you'll have failover times, something like that. If a client will failover times, because if your IP address has changed, so we all know what DNS is, right? You have a domain name and you want to get the IP address of that domain name. So you go to the DNS with that domain name and then the DNS will return an IP address. So sometimes it so happens that the domains actually keep on changing the IP addresses. And so that has to be updated in the DNS entry, right? So if your TTL, and if it updates, but that update will happen only when the TTL is reached, okay, the time to leave is reached. So when the time to leave expires, then only the new, whatever that new value will be cached. Because if every time any client request comes in and hits the server, it is going to be a more load on the server. So all the DNS entries are actually cached, okay? And the cache has a TTL. So that is what I mean by TTL. And if the TTL is long, so you will have, because even the IP address is changed, but the cache doesn't have the latest value. So the client will still get the stale value and they'll keep on failing, right? So, and in the other way, if the TTL was smaller, okay? So every time you'll always have a TTL timeout and then you will have a flushing of the cache and you will again go to the DNS and again you are going to overload the DNS, right? So therefore the TTL has to be chosen in a very wise way. But they say Google actually resolved this issue and internally they were using Chubby for that. So the way Chubby works is, so actually whenever you make an entry in the Chubby node, okay, exactly at the time, when before you are even making an entry into that Chubby node, and also the Chubby monitors all the caches and it has a list of all the cached data for all the nodes. So that list is maintained in the Chubby master. And whenever we are going to modify that particular node, so at that time, it actually invalidates all that cache. So everything in that cache or the client side is flushed. So, and then it modifies whenever, and it also waits for an acknowledgement from all the clients. So when it gets the acknowledgement, then only it goes and updates the value in the server. So the next time, whenever a request comes from the client, it will hit the server, the first one, and then it will be copied to the cache. So therefore, if you look at it, always the cache value is, there won't be any stale value at all. It will always be the latest value. And therefore, if you implement the same thing on a DNS, so you will never have a failover. Okay, every time you will have the latest data. Yeah, there might be some performance issue because you will have to go and hit the server some cases. So there will be some performance impact, but not huge. So whenever you have change, you are actually immediately going to change the value in the cache for that particular entry. And also it's not going to follow the update service because it just changed. Whenever value is changed in server, only those entries are actually modified. Right. So therefore it is more efficient. That is what it's they claim that the naming service, what they have been using instead of DNS, if it's used as a Chubby with the Chubby, then it is more efficient way of doing it. So that is what I said over here. Okay. And now what we have about storage. So storage is nothing but, you know, and also as Shashank was looking for this one. So the storage, whatever the data, whenever a client request comes in and tries to access a log in the Chubby. So when you open a log, you would like to actually write something to the in that file, or maybe a key value store, something like that, right? So that actually is the storage. So this storage is a very small. We don't have to store huge database. What we can store is more about the configuration or maybe some part of whatever is required to actually synchronize between two distributed processes or maybe two distributed clients. Okay, so that data is very minimal because we just have to keep all the data which is very common to both of them, and so we can easily access, right? So so that way all the clients are very independently working and they are not very tightly bound with each other. So they are still loosely bound in a distributed system, but they still would like to communicate in some way, and that communication or the data sharing is very minimal, and that is what the storage is. Okay, so and that part efficiently done in this case along with the logs, it has a storage also, and that is very small. So if we don't had the storage here, okay, we just had a log service without the storage, then our clients would have to rely on another service for the storage. So that will be overhead on a client side to access two different services. So, but if we have both of them combined together in case of Chubby, so that becomes more efficient. It's only one service to access and you get both of them. But most of the time when you have a log, you still need some data also most of the time. Right? So therefore they have combined together, and therefore that is what they talk about the storage. And the distributed locking mechanism, the same what we are discussing about the coarse grained lock and the fine grained locks. Right? So this is what the whole thing about the common use cases, what is also explained in the book. Anything you want to add, anyone?
Coarse is like for large data, right? Large files.
I also I'm not very sure about it. Yeah, it's like for the data, right?
For the coarse, right? So you wanna lock a whole table, then you use the coarse grain, whereas fine grain is like one row in a table to lock that. So that purpose they use for.
Mm-hmm. Oh, every row in a table. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so they sometimes they say not the database, not the table, the whole database also. One table is also still in cases it might be smaller if the table is smaller, but if it's huge, yeah, it makes sense. But instead of going row by row, row will be the most smallest resolution in this case, the database. Yeah. Yeah. So now if we look about the design rationale or whatever it is called, so what is actually the reason for doing all this? The first thing which comes out is the whole thing, the Chubby, is designed as a lock service. You know, I just have only single diagram over here for today. But if you look at here, all the dotted one is a Chubby. And so we have five replicas, and one of them is a master. And we have an application, client application, along with that, it has a Chubby library. So it is, the Chubby library is linked with the client. So, and both of these Chubby library actually communicates with the Chubby using RPC protocols. So this is what actually the very high level thing is. So what it is said is, the Chubby is implemented as a log service and over a distributed consensus. But if you were to implement using a Paxos library, how different it would be? So the second point actually talks about that. So both of these points are almost similar to each other. So if we were supposed to do that implementation in the client application itself, instead of going through this, what will happen is, if you have different clients or different components in the same client, you know, and so everyone will have to have its own library and will have to actually have that own distributed consensus. So you'll have to have they will have a replicas. So then they will have to coordinate with each other. So, and implementing or using the Paxos library, you'll have to implement all that state machine and all that stuff. So there will be, first of all, there will be over duplication, because the same library for a particular component will have to be used in many places. And then there will be a lot of code involved in it also. So it is always good to have all of that as a separate service. And if you have a separate service for different clients, okay, or in the same client, if there are many components, okay, so all of them just go and look at the master, look at that Chubby cell and find who is the master and all that. So that becomes more easier, you know, because you have moved out all the common functionalities from your client into a service now. And that service now, if you make that as a service, the another part of services, you can replicate it. And you can also, when you replicate, you make it highly available and you can scale it and all that stuff, right? So that way it becomes more reliable. The reliability increases, and you client application, you don't have to have duplication. So if you have a single client with a single node, it can still work very easily. Just go and create a node in the master and then go from there, right? If your application doesn't demand for application, all this stuff. So still that is more easier. And so single point of failure and all this stuff actually can be handled in much better way, right? So that is what they say about when it talks about the log service over the library and just having a log service, how different it is. And secondly, the third part is where you store the leader election data for advertisement. So as we know that if there are many such clients, they are competing to be a leader. So the first one actually who writes in the master's node will be the leader for sure. So, but how does it actually advertise that he is a leader? So he will write the value of its own, maybe something like the IP address and all that stuff, or maybe it will have a different alias name or something. So that will be, so the other replicas of the client will actually open that log in a shared mode, and they will know that who is the master, right? So that is why it is said here, it stores the leader election data for advertisement. So advertisement in the sense, it can be shared across different clients also, or maybe in the same replicas of the same client. So everyone is sharing that data, and that is what it talks about here. It's not only the election data, but other data also can be shared for the advertisement. So this is what the point about here. So is this okay to you, Shashank?
Yeah. So there, I mean, all the followers know that, like, he is the leader, something like that, right? For advertising it.
That information. Say that.
Same thing happens in Paxos also, right? Paxos or Raft.
Like, well, yeah. These almost all are similar, you know. But this one is slightly different. And so I was trying to find out what actually difference is, you know. And so it is more easier for us to really understand how it stands out. Okay. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So there is question by Nick. I think, I mean, does each Chubby client connect to master? That's the case, right? Every client in Chubby will connect with the master for read and write. Right.
Yeah, yeah, that is what they said. So master is the main thing here. You always, for read as well as for write, you connect to the master. But when you want to write, what it does, you know, it actually follows a majority vote also in this case. So whenever it actually writes, so it writes to the master first, but then it is replicated across all the replicas. But then it waits for an acknowledgement for the majority of the replicas. If it is five in this
quorum,
case, wait for three. Yeah, sort of quorum you can say, but they don't call it quorum, I think, here. Maybe it's internally maintained, you know. And then when you get an acknowledgement for all of them, then only it returns back to the client. So that is what the write happens. That is the way it happens. But for the read, it always reads from the master. It doesn't
they
have
want a strong consistency, right? So that's the reason I think they want to do the copy at every node. Then only they send back to the client saying that the request is success.
Right, right. Exactly. Yeah.
There's availability will also be higher in that case, right? Because it's being replicated to all the nodes, right, by the master.
Yeah, so in this case...
No, I'm saying availability... That's why it's highly available because of this replication factor, right?
Availability is like, yeah, replication has to be for availability. But if you are writing it, you know, you are actually replicating it at the same time. So you are actually acknowledging it a bit delayed, isn't it?
The latency will be there.
Yeah,
sure,
so that
right?
Performance, yeah, they are fine with that performance hit, yeah. So, yeah, you can say latency hit on that.
But consistency will be good because until and unless all of them, I mean, the client gets acknowledgement from every cell, like every cell of the Chubby, he won't accept it, right? So, strongly consistent, it makes it.
Yeah, it is. You know, frankly, they don't say strong, they say strict consistency. So, there might be something about it because you cannot say strong consistency and as well as high availability as per the CAP theorem, correct? So you have availability as well as consistency, but therefore they say strict consistency. So I don't know whether it is really strict itself is a strong, but yeah, that is what actually
I mean, availability here is not in the sense of like, I mean, there's not many rights, right?
Oh yeah, is right. Yeah.
Yeah. So in that sense, it's highly available. But not in like CAP theorem sense where the service is always available. It can take many writes. You know?
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah, that makes sense because you have low writes. And
moreover, you also said, right, like, why not from replica? Why not read from replica? Mm-hmm. Probably it's also like on write, the cache is also invalidated, right?
Yes. Yeah. Yeah, most of the time it's going to the cache, correct? Yeah.
Yeah.
So read can be done from replica also, no? But it's not like that, right? It has to do from master only.
No, most of the time, it will always be done from the cache.
Cache.
93% of the time, they say there is one some data somewhere. It is done from the cache.
This cache is on the application side or is on the server side?
No, it's on the application side. Yeah. It's with the library.
So somebody will flush data to that cache, right?
Well, okay, I mean, so it's a write through cache. Okay, so whenever you write, you know, if you want to update previously written data, so what you do is you actually, this master will have a list of where the cache is, you know. So every time, whatever the entry is for a particular client application based on the client library, because see, these RPCs, the way they are communicating, the library and the server, the way it is communicating using RPCs. And these RPCs are actually periodic, like the keep alive, you know. So there will always be a keep alive periodically happening. So they are not actually using separate communication methods. They are always using a keep alive period. So whenever you have a cache update, they still use that keep alive. And also acknowledgement also is done by the keep alive only. But in the keep alive, they have different fields. That is where they set it. Okay, so therefore it is always a periodic. It's like you can say some sort of a synchronous operation periodically done, you know. So that is what it is. So whenever you are updating a particular data in the master. So you know that it has been updated in some client application based on the list which the master maintains. So immediately the master will send for over the RPC for the next keep alive, because whenever keep alive is received from the Chubby library to the master, it has to send an ACK also, right? So when it is sending an ACK, at that time it will send to that Chubby library saying, okay, now you have to invalidate or flush your data from that particular cache. So then this guy will flush it, and the next time when he's sending a keep alive, he will say, okay, I've done that, okay, and this is my keep alive, and this is my that I've already flushed that data, and then the master can update the data. So that is what the whole process is.
So these RPCs follows TCP protocol?
No, it is a remote procedure call.
Oh, okay.
It's a remote procedure call. It is a direct call between the library and the mass, the cell, the Chubby cell. Yeah.
I think internally they may use the either TCP, right? TCP or UDP. I don't know, the RPC.
If some communication,
yeah,
some protocol,
yeah.
Or
it might be based on IP. It might use TCP or UDP. Or
it will be a raw socket, I think.
Yeah, when you say
raw socket on IP.
That only rings to me, you know.
Yeah.
When you say keep alive, I think of sockets only.
It has to be. Yeah, it has to be socket, right? Yeah.
Sockets, I mean web sockets. By direction, I mean.
So there are different ways, right? TCP socket, UDP socket, or the raw socket. Right, so
okay.
it can be the raw socket at the IP level, because if you go for the TCP or UDP, they are at the upper layer, right? The TCP or UDP layer. But if you go for the IP, it will be at the lower level.
Yeah, because here you are receiving ACK, right? Acknowledgement. So that brings us a hint of TCP, right? I mean, two-way handshake protocol kind of. Otherwise, the data would be lost. So,
yeah,
I'm assuming
maybe we'll go through that later about the details, you know. Yeah, but what exactly that RPC?
Okay.
Yeah.
Let me just add, say one RPC message is there, right? Say the message is very big, okay? Then we can split into two parts, okay? Then for the each part that will be sent over the TCP, right? So TCP has to do the acknowledgement for each each part actually. So once all parts are acknowledged by the TCP, then actually RPC will actually get all the packets, then it will merge it, then it will make one RPC, right? So RPC will again, it has to send one more acknowledgement to saying that, yeah, I received complete RPC. So there are like two level of ACK will be sent.
So underlying architecture is TCP only, right? First, small segments will be acknowledged by TCP. Once all the segments are received, RPC will give a final acknowledgement.
Yeah, right. It's like that. So if RPC uses the TCP, I'm just giving an example. If the packet is very big, then we need to segment, right? For that purpose, I'm just saying.
Yes.
Well, see, these remote procedure calls are basically, you know, if you have a distributed process, if you have a process, two processes, and if you have a function in a different process, you are like, if you have P1 process and P2 process, and if you have some foo process, which is in process P2, and if you want to execute that, so that you can do by RPC. You know, it's like just a function call you are doing in one process, but that function is implemented in the second process, and they are two different independent processes. So these processes can be in the same machine, or they can be in a different cross machines.
So RPC is mostly for cross machines. I mean, in the different.
In this
places.
Case, it is, right? Because we have a client separately and then we have master separate, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And it's more of a tightly bound that way, because it has to know all the details about the other function, what is calling about, right? So therefore, they are not very generically implemented. It is very tightly bound. Okay.
Yeah, so just one question. Sorry to interrupt. Yeah. So we are saying it is strict consistency, right? So in that case, why all the requests has to go to the master? So it can go to followers as well, right? If we have strict consistency.
Why it has go to the master?
Yeah, I mean, for all the read and
it goes to master.
It needs to go to master, right? So why all the requests has to go to master if you have a strict consistency.
No, that's a good point, right? They could have gone to follow us and read it, right?
Well, see, the way they want to do is, you know, because the replicas actually are just followers, and they are used only for the failover in this case. So other than that, the replica has no use. Also, another case, whenever a request lands on a replica, it will just forward. Looking at the DNS, it will forward to the master. So that is the only thing it can do. Okay.
But
so,
generally for read every system, we make replicas, right? Because so that it will be, I mean, if the system is highly readable, we mm-hmm. replicate those things so that it will be divided, right? So
yeah.
Here also, like,
so that we can actually scale it. If you allow to follow to read.
Exactly. Yeah, that is correct. But what I think, you know, what they are trying to do here in this case, in case if your master fails, your replica if is not updated, you know, in that case. So you'll have to have that replica updated. I think.
But the replica will be updated, right? Because we are following the strict consistency.
Yeah, because
consistency is just a node failover. I mean, just... I mean, you can have only one server and do all this stuff, but to avoid the faults in the system, failing of nodes. So that's why at least the term here is used as such.
Hmm.
So
frankly, what you say makes sense, Ri. You know, I'm also not very sure why they are doing it, but they say, okay, every time it is done that way. And Zookeeper doesn't do it that way, right? Zookeeper actually allows to read from the replicas.
Yeah,
at least from the read side, but here they don't. That is one thing very clear. But yeah, I didn't see anything.
Do we know that? I mean, it's because we don't know, right? How many servers will also be there in a cell?
No, they say it's usually five.
Usually they say five.
Five, yeah.
Yeah, they say five, but it's not the exact number, right?
Okay. Yeah. I also need to check on that. That's a good one then. Because always I thought it's going to be always five. And if they have cross DCs, they have also not mentioned it, how it is going to be, whether it is going to be five or three or anything odd. But yeah.
I mean, if you're talking about consistency, that if the data needs to be replicated to all nodes, then we could have read from even the followers, right? Replicas.
Mm-hmm. But see.
So I have a question.
Yeah, go ahead.
The question is, we are saying strict consistency is because the way we have this chubby is designed, or the reason I'm saying is because what we are saying is the read will be always happening from master because master has the latest information. All the followers or replicas could be asyncly replicated, right? So if you are going to read from only one of the replica, you might be getting stale data.
Yeah, that is perfectly right. Yeah.
If you want consistency, exactly. You will need at least n by two or more than that reads from this one, right?
Yeah.
And considering there are high reads, it is advised to not go to all the nodes or more nodes, right? If you can just read from master, and anyways, the cache is there to update with the keep alive part that you mentioned, right? Mm-hmm. So I think it is lesser hits on the master also, right? If given that, considering that part.
So I think that what he said is correct, right? See, because it always reads from master and it is also cached. And also whenever we have to update, you are going to register for those events also. So most of the time you will always hit from the cache. You will always take the inputs from the cache and you are going to rarely hit the master in that case. And if you want to read the very, be more consistent, strict consistent, not a strong consistent, you can say. So in that case, you just can go to the master. You cannot go to the replica because the replica might be in what you say, the replication mode, and the data might be stale in that case. Yeah. Okay.
But
that is a good point. Yeah. Sorry.
But you send ACK only when you write on n number of replicas, right? So that means all the replicas are up to date. I mean, quorum kind of thing.
That's when.
That is also true. Yeah, but see, what happens, you know, these RPCs are again periodic, right? So they might have some time constants there also. They might have, it's like a synchronous periodically updation, okay? So it is updating. So during that time, the when it is actually sending the acts and all that thing, there might be some place, some point, where the data might not be consistent on the replicas. That is what I think, you know, because it is still in the flight mode and the data is trying to be replicated at the other places before it gives an ACK, right? At that time, if someone is trying to read it from the replica, then he might get a stale data, right? Just forget for some time, we don't have a chubby library cache, okay? And every time it is going to hit the master, and whenever it is actually trying to replicate at that time, before if it is replicated to two of them instead of three, and someone actually hits on the third server, so he will get a stale data. So that might be one case I would think about.
So what do you mean by strict consistency then?
Nikki is saying is strong. I don't know in chat.
No. See, this is the case. In case if we say client cache is not there, okay, and then we are actually reading from the replicas also instead of reading from the master. So if we read from master, it's very clear it is going to be strict consistency, isn't it? So because you write to the master always and you read from there. So that will be a very simple way of saying it is going to be strict consistency based on it. Okay. But now when we actually are replicating it on the replicas, and then only we actually act to the particular client, and then we actually update in the cache also, right? So that also they don't want to take a chance. Okay. So actually they completely replicate and then send an ACK to the cache, and then only the cache is actually invalidated. Isn't it? So at that time also, when it is doing,
that's right, Santosh. Write through cache pass, it write on the cache, then it is write on the backend server, right?
But when you are actually modifying any value for the first write, it is fine. But when you are modifying, you know, when you are updating a value which is already written, at that time, what it does is it actually invalidates the cache, and then it holds any writes because it doesn't update on the node also. So whenever he gets all the acts from the cache, that all the data is flushed out, okay, then only it updates. For cache updation is slightly different that way. Yeah, maybe we'll come to that, how it is updated. Yeah, but this is what, yeah, so that is a very good point. And I think why it is strictly consistent is because we always read from the master in a very high level, and we are not reading from the replicas.
So you're saying the strict consistency between the master and the clients?
Yeah.
Not the between the servers in the cluster?
No, not that.
Okay.
So that is only just for the replication.
Master, right? And clients, it's always like strict consistent, right? Even if you don't use the word, because you always have latest.
And do we maintain quorum here also, or it is only once you write the master means?
That is the question, actually. That is the question. So whether the replication is synchronous or asynchronous, whether the write is, you know, has a quorum or not.
So it's written point number 6. If you see the design distributed consensus.
The client might read from the stale node, right? So
that's right. Yeah, so this is what actually the whole design rationale is, you know, whatever has been discussed, we were discussing, right? Yeah.
But it's contradicting a little bit, I don't know. I mean,
but the way strict consistency is like that, right? So you always read
but the use case of this is very different from others. That's why it is like that.
To typical DB, it's a bit different.
Right.
Yep.
And this is an engineering paper, right? So we don't know why they choose this way.
Yeah. Well, okay. So the other thing, you know, what we actually did with this leader election advertisement, right? And now the lock-based interface, because it says that all the programmers community is more, you know, inclined towards lock other than implementing a Paxos-based state machine, right? So therefore, it is more familiarity of the programmer community, and it makes sense also, right? So therefore, if you use something like a Paxos replicated state machine, it seems to be like more, it gives an illusionary of you are doing a sequential programming and all that stuff. But if you use it with the logs, it's more about you doing the concurrent programming, right? So that is actually what it says in these cases. And coarse-grained lock is something which can you can hold it for a very long time. And the fine grain, in that case, it's you just you know, hold it for a very small time, or else you are going to have a hit on the, you're going to stall the clients and all that stuff, right? So therefore, the coarse grain is being used here, and it makes more sense in this use case, right? And now we discussed about the distributed consensus algorithm, which uses Quorum to make any decisions, so that we have several replicas to achieve the high availability and the, all that stuff. And here they are talking about five replicas in each cell. That is what they are also very explicitly saying here. And three of them should always be running up in a cell. You know? So that is what the configuration should be. And then what they say is actually the lock service is a way of providing a generic electorate. No, that allows all the client system to make their decisions very correctly, because all of these clients will, so many of the clients will actually be writing in different nodes. So they can have a single point where they can actually get the electorate of each and every client component. And that becomes more easier to maintain, because all that data is at one place and is being taken care of by the service for all the distributed issues in that particular service. So we don't have to bother about. And okay, sorry. And then, so the last, before even go to the last point, what is being said is that the real key design decision, you know, we have to use a lock service. Why the lock service was chosen as opposed to library or the service of consensus, because it actually serves the small files, you know, to permit whatever the election what we are doing, and when we store the data in small files, okay, and then we advertisement with all the parameters and all that stuff, so we don't have to use two different services. So everything is being done in a single service, right? So therefore, that is a very key function over here. And that is why actually the major design actually is, you know, centered around those two things. One is the lock service and actually maintaining a small data or maybe the key value store, whatever you can call it, the small repository. And that is a key for Chubby to stand out, you know, from the other systems. I don't know how it is in ZooKeeper though. But that is what actually they claim in many places. One thing what has been said, that service advertising its primary or maybe the master via Chubby file may have thousands of clients. Therefore, we must allow all the thousands of clients to observe this file, preferably without needing many servers, right? So If we save any data on a particular locks file or the key value store, so that data is actually exposed to like thousands of clients, you know. So they can open that lock in a shared mode and they can easily share it just by using a single service and not having to implement more servers, so to increase the bandwidth, or if you to give some relief to the bandwidth. If many of those clients are actually hitting this particular location. Okay, so that is why actually this is a service-based system, and that makes it more important. And the second is, so also whenever there are changes in any of the logs, the way we discuss actually it is event notified to those particular client libraries, client Chubby libraries. And therefore, that data will be updated. But in case Some cases we still will be polling, but then you will actually have a caching also for those whatever the files. Okay, so this is what actually is. And now if we just quickly run through the system structure, I don't have much details about this, but the way it is slightly interesting and would like to cover here is, as we see, we have only two components. One is the Chubby library here, and then the second is the Chubby cell, isn't it? And then we have a communication between both of them using the RPC. And now what happens, Chubby cell consists of all the small servers. They are actually five and they are called replicas. One has to be master. And the master, the way it is elected is it obtains votes from the majority of the replicas. Okay. And it also promises that whenever it is elected, it promises that the other replicas are not going to vote for a certain interval, and that interval is called as a master lease. Okay. And the master lease is renewed periodically by the replicas if the master is still winning the majority of the vote. Okay. And so the replicas will maintain copies of the database. So whatever is the database on the master, that also data will be maintained on the replicas. But the master will initiate the read writes of this database, and other replicas will just have a copy from the master. And that is also done by the consensus protocol. Okay. And so now what happens, how does a client know about the master? Because it might always say it look for a DNS, and from the DNS, it might go through all the replicas. And so the non-master replicas will respond to those requests from the client. Okay, and they will actually return the master address. And the next time whenever the client gets the master address, it will, from the next time, it will keep on interacting with the master. So they will use always a DNS, you know. So whenever you have, from the DNS is going to hit any of the replicas, and the replicas will return, if it's a non-master, it will return to the client saying the master, give its master address, and then the Chubby library along with the Chubby client actually will keep on interacting with the master till the master has not failed over or actually is not changed. Till that time it will keep, or maybe it's not in the master release also. If the master release is not expired, till that time it will keep on interacting with that same master over and over again. And so this is what they talked about in this case. And the third one is one important point. If we have a Chubby cell here, and what happens if one of these replica, or maybe you can call a node, that fails, you know, and that fails and that doesn't recover for a very long time, say like maybe a few hours. So how does a new replica is being added in this Chubby cell? So the way it is said, it is being done, what it does is it picks up any of the nodes from a free pool. And the free pool, this particular node is completely virgin in the sense it doesn't have any data on it. So the first thing what it will do is the system will actually run a lock server binary on it. And when the lock server binary runs on it, so it will surely have its own IP address. And that IP address is actually updated in the DNS table for the previously failed replica. So it will be just replaced with this IP address. And then whenever the master communicates with the DNS, also the master also has one function of communicating with the DNS periodically, and eventually it will notice the change. So when he notices the change, then it will actually start building up that replica, which is newly joined. And the way it does is it actually gets all the data from the file server along with the active replicas as a backup. Oh, and so the backups of this active replica also update the whatever the data, what the new this node is being brought out or a bootstrap, along with the file server will also have the whole data. So all that data along with the backups of this active replicas actually help this new node to ramp up. And when it is actually in a state and So whenever a new write comes in from a client, and then the master actually tries to replicate across the replicas, and the current new replica which is building up actually responds. It will only respond when it has the whole data. So when it responds, at that time the master will recognize and it will give the rights for it to vote in the next leader election. Okay, so this is what is one of the way to add a follower, a new node into a chubby cell when current one is actually failed for a, or maybe it is out for a very long time. So yeah, so these were some of the things which I thought would like to go through, and rest of the things we can discuss later. Yeah, sorry, go ahead.
So is the replication from master to replicas is synchronous? Just in case of master failover, what happens? Do we lose the data or what?
So you are saying if the master has a data and the failover happens,
mm-hmm.
right? So you are saying, does it lose the data? Well,
I take that back. I think you already mentioned before updating, it gets the acknowledgement from all the replicas until it sends a acknowledgement back to the chubby library, right? So that means that it is synchronous update.
Yeah, that is. And in case, even okay. if it's updating and if it doesn't acknowledge, so if it still has the latest data, so the client will actually not get acknowledged. That is one thing. So it will have to again send a request. That is for,
Even log is there, right?
That is what I said, you know. Yeah, I was about to say that. So if the way it is said over here, I think even
Shreya
might be knowing, right? So we say, a single replicated log. So this to me looks like a write ahead log. So whenever you are actually implementing, you know, this might be committed to some other place. And also when I was looking at this portion where we actually add a new node, we are actually replacing one of the failed node. So at that time also it talks to file server, you know, because the file server will have all the data till now, you know. So I think that is also one thing which where the logs go, write ahead logs. Maybe I don't know. There is another component to this cell, chubby cell, which actually keeps the commit logs, because see every time any replica can fail over and become a master or maybe just become a follower, right? So there has to be a centralized place where you can always pull up a data for a new node to join this chubby cell. So I think first that might be one way.
They might write to the log first and then to the master.
I think so. Maybe.
So if they maintain a separate storage, right, that will be burden. Right? Instead, the new node can get from the leader. The master will be the most upgrade, so it can get it from that, right?
Mm-hmm.
So why do they maintain one?
Yeah,
that's a overhead for maintenance.
Yeah, that is also a good point. But then what is about this a single replicated log? I didn't understand that.
They might be talking about for each server they maintain a replicate log. Because edit log has to maintain for each server. Maybe I don't know, maybe they're talking about the shared log for all server. I don't think that makes sense. Shared log for all the follower, all the leader and follower.
Is it in the context of like master? Like only the master takes all the rights, right? So in that sense, so it is that like source of truth for the log.
Only master might be having that replicated log, right?
Yeah.
No, followers also has to maintain.
Followers should have it, right? Because it's persisted everywhere.
Followers do maintain, but the master will dictate it, right?
Yeah. I think it is something like the SS tables and all that stuff, isn't it? So that has to be there, no? Internally.
They maintain internally. It logs
Cassandra and all we have, right? SS tables. Mm-hmm. They write to replicated log, wall,
Because this is also key value storage. Yeah, you can have a database. You know, in some cases, they have this log. And then it talks to a database to get all the file storage. So that is also one model in some where you require a special storage. Yeah, sorry.
Yeah, I have read some system. I don't remember exactly that one, but what they say is like this log, right, edit log, they maintain multiple tables, and then there is one more abstraction to that tables. So each offset of that table will be maintained one high level. So from that, they'll get to know which table to, which SS table to get the data. Maybe that sense they're telling everything is, instead of maintaining all sub files, they may say like only one table maintains of all the edit log. Mm-hmm. That's what maybe they're saying about. I'm not sure.
Yeah, maybe. Yeah, that makes sense.
So one question here, say now the master will try to broadcast the change, right? For all the clients. Say one client is, he did not get, maybe it went to some sleep mode, some failover, and then came back. So how does that case is handled? How that client will get the data again for the change?
So you are saying master will update, it update the
point number, right? Point number seven, when master got the change, is trying to broadcast to the clients. But the but some reason the client did not get the broadcast because of some failover at that side.
Or you mean to say the client failover?
Yeah, yeah. Maybe for some very few minutes, it's about to get the message. That time only the client did not get it somehow because of its internal issue or something. Then
you can retry.
Okay. Yeah.
But then again, Santosh mentioned. Santosh mentioned synchronous replication, right? When he talked about acknowledgements on.
You have to have an acknowledgement for sure. Without that, it doesn't happen. Only it's a periodic synchronization. You know, you use that RPCs. Yeah.
I mean, for maintaining that strong consistency, we need like synchronous replication. But then again, we have a lot of servers, right? Like this five servers, we don't know where they are located. And how many of them respond will respond in time. So
well, it says in a single rack most of the time. They are not even talking about cross racks. They talk in some cases. Yeah. But yeah, actually, you see, whenever we have such replicas, so the replica speed and everything has to be taken into account, you know. So if you have a slow replica, it has to be moved out, because this is a coordination service. It has to be very consistent, reliable, right? So, and also you look at the data, it's very small. You don't have a huge data. So, and the whole of the configuration is based on this particular service. So if this service itself is not, it's very flaky, then the other client applications will be troubled, isn't it? So therefore they will have the most fastest replicas always in this. So that should not be a point, but if it in case, yeah, then there might be a way to resolve it.
So you mean the broadcast probably, changes, are you talking in terms of the master to followers?
So this master, the year this broadcast, what will happen whenever there is a file change in any of these chubby cells, right? Mm-hmm. So that will actually broadcast it by based on the way we do it, watches in Zookeeper. Here you have events. So you have to actually configure it for those events. So that way, actually, it is broadcasted. So if there is any change, you know. So whenever the failover happens, so all of these clients know the failover has happened and the new master has been elected. So that is one event. So the events are, one is if the content of the file changes. And the second is if you add a child to a node, or you delete or remove or update a child, right? So these four, and the other one is failover, if a master fails over. So that has to be broadcasted to all the clients which are interested in their particular master.
Okay, so at that time the client did not receive it. So how does that case will be handled?
If the client doesn't receive it, so when it goes in sleep, so it is not doing anything. So when it comes back, isn't it? So when it comes back, it is still going to go back to the same route, because it will go to the DNS, it will go to hit on any of the, if it hits on a non-master replica, so it will be forwarded to the master, isn't it?
Oh yeah, it will.
So it doesn't have a data, so it doesn't have a data at that time, it is sleeping. So it has been updated, but it doesn't have a data. But still it will go to the master, and then it will have to collect it from there. So because then they might store some way saying, okay, this particular cache has not been updated. Because it can, if the master can maintain a list of all the cache details for each and every client application, so it should also maintain saying, okay, this cache has been updated or not, for the strict consistency requirement. That is what I think. Or else,
yeah,
it won't be able to possible, right? Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, as you say, on write, it is already evicted, right? So it will definitely hit the master.
Yeah. It will hit the master also, but Sri's question is how, if it is going down, so the client won't know, you know, there is a new change. So forget about the master failover, but if there is some change in some content, you know, for a particular
some content type, change,
yeah. So how that will be replicated. So this is the way I would think. So whenever it goes back to the master, so it will look for its entry that has not been updated. So for the next RPC act, you know, it will actually send all the data. It has to actually keep that Chubby's library cache in sync with the master.
So if client is directly talking to master to get to know about change, that's fine. So if the client is not approaching the master and trying to use its cache, right? So, but it missed the change, but it's trying to use the cache, whatever data it uses. So that time there could be a problem, right?
Yeah. So you are saying that when it goes down at that time, there was some change in the master and that is not updated in the cache.
Yeah. That time it's trying to use it, the client. So,
and when it comes back, you see that it gets the stale data.
Yeah.
But see, in this client application also, see, it will have a replica, right? So these are like, it will maintain a replica because it's still going to be a distributed system, the whole client. So it will have its own replica. So one of the master goes down in that case. Okay. Yeah. So you are saying what happens if the master goes down? So how the replicas get updated? Yeah, that's a good
like
question.
Cache is there, but master went down, but client doesn't know that. So,
So how do they do in a curator then?
So in Zookeeper, so how do they do is like when the client is, I mean, there's session, right? They maintain session. So they, I mean, they watch for watches, and then to get the update, but thinking if it's not getting update, it's going to some sleep, right? So that time the session expiry will happen. So the client has to reconnect freshly.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so these also actually connect by session.
These are anyway notified by the watchers. So, I mean, is there any notification here? Like something is updated to the
events.
Yeah.
So it is notified by events. That is right. But the way it is being done, because this also actually establishes a session, you know, it also creates a ephemeral node or the regular node. So that also happens in this case. But if the content changes, I don't know whether the state of that ephemeral node changes.
Yeah, can I ask here?
Sure. Yeah, please.
Yeah, as we discussed, when client want to change something at master, master have to notify all clients, to validate the cache, So, but if we have a lot of client, let's say 1,000, master will have to notify all 1,000 client, and if one of that client is not reachable, we cannot change the value,
That is a good point. Okay, because it's a strict consistency, right?
Yeah, it's not clear how to deal in this case, but if client was not favored by but just stuck for some delay, what should master do? If just one of them is not just stuck,
I think peer clients can also help to update whenever that client comes up, right? I mean, rather than again hitting the master.
So what they say is, it's very interesting, always the master is in control, you know, that is what they are saying. The way what I read till now, maybe if I read more, I might understand it to some extent. But as far as now, I don't know about it, very frankly. So whatever C mentioned, as also Nick actually has a question here. Yeah, that is simply something... Yeah, I need to actually explore more. But if you guys also explore, just let us know.
So follow-up question on the next question. Is it master pushing the notification to the Chubby library, or I thought Chubby is actually periodically polling master? And as part of the acknowledgement you mentioned, master will send a flag saying that you have to invalidate the cache. So if the client is disconnected for some reason, why would a master has to bother about it, right? Because that client will reconnect back, and that point when it reconnects back to master, master is going to send acknowledgement saying that you have to invalidate your cache.
Mm-hmm.
No, but if all the clients start doing like that, asking master, then what is the use of 0.7, right? Broadcasting changes.
See, I mean, broadcasting changes is like you actually...
It's replication.
Replication sort of, right? Yeah.
It's not about this part. It's broadcast to primary file changes could be related to this, as I said, with replication, not...
Mm-hmm. Yeah, not between client and servers.
I may be wrong, but it might broadcast about the file changes, but it may drop because of the timeout also, right? It doesn't want to wait for that client to be up. It will just mark that, okay, if that client comes back again, when it reconnects back to master, it will anyways has to revalidate its cache.
Yeah, I think so. That might happen. You know, it has to revalidate, then only it will work, right? So whenever it goes down for some time, so then the cache actually, they might take some action instead of actually master keeping up, doing a bookkeeping.
If what Vaibhav said, you know, if it is polling, then we won't be having these problems, right?
Mm.
Because it will regularly poll and all the changes have been broadcast from the master to the replicas, right? They will definitely know.
It does both the things, you know. It also gets an event notifications if there are changes, but it also polls. The client library also polls. So that also happens, yeah.
But if so many
then
clients
won't be having this problem, right?
No, but if so many clients poll at this...
No, poll interval will be somewhat periodic and the time interval will be very long. It will not be that often. So every system, right, when I have like some kind of updating, like watchers, they do polling as well because they miss, right, sometime. So to get a sync with the server, they do polling. It's a very long interval usually.
Yeah, but in this case, the polling is done on the keep alive periodical. So that is fine, you know. It's not going to have a burden on the server. So everything is actually done periodically synchronous.
So when you say keep alive, do you mean the polling is health check?
Looks like that.
Sorry, could you come again?
I mean, you said the polling, in order to keep alive, right? You do the polling, right? Is it health check or like...
keep alive is health check for sure. Keep
alive health check for the session.
But the only thing is, how will it know that a particular cache itself is to be invalidated? So whenever, as Sri said, you know, whenever the master goes down for some time, it comes up. The best way would be invalidate all the cache, you know. And that might be something the client library should handle because it knows that state has changed, you know. It has gone back and based on the time, if it's more than the periodic updation, so it should actually invalidate it. And for the next time it pulls all the data, the master should flush in. Or maybe whenever its client reads, that actually data will come into that cache. That is what I think. But whenever we read the cache, we'll get more inputs. Yeah. Sorry, Kiki, go ahead.
No, go ahead. Yeah, I was thinking maybe because we studied Cassandra, right? We know how to detect changes. Through hashes, you know, probably that might, I don't know.
Merkle trees.
So you say the anti entropy, how it actually keeps on updating.
Yeah, basically hashes of the data,
but
you know.
This is the client side, no? Yeah, so I don't know. It's very interesting, yeah.
But those are two storage databases, right? I don't think Merkle tree will work. I mean, this is a very small storage kind of thing, right? These Jury and all.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. And what exactly we store in like files? I'm just thinking, is it just ACLs or just some metadata? Other than that, do you have anything?
Yeah, most of it is metadata and anything really required to synchronize between two different clients or processes. And also ACLs, you store the ACL files for sure. And then like the primary election, you store its IP address and details of that particular server, who is the primary or the master. That is at least what I know for now. Okay. But you can do anything. See, if you imagine, if you are using this log to log a critical section, and then if you are trying to use it as a mutex and you want to log for a particular shared resource, So what are the things you would actually try to store, you know? So those things can, you know, That is what I'm thinking. I mean, in case if you are actually working on some file and then you want to actually, it's like not a normal file, which actually looks into a storage driver, but if it is something to do with the streaming, right? So you will have to maintain some offset and all those things. So that also data can be stored into it. It all depends on the application.
Then comparing changes also will be easy, right? Like this information is like pretty small.
Yeah.
Unlike the database stuff. But it just a comparison of hashes. You calculate hash and you check if there are any changes or anything.
Okay. You are saying just look for the hash changes, you know, if the hash changes or my CRC changes, then you actually update that. Yeah, makes sense. Yeah, frankly, I didn't read more about the caching part.
I'm just guessing. I read this like a long, like, I don't know. Like, these details are even hardly remember anything.
Yep, no problem. Good. Yeah.